Hey guys, Jason Shellcross of the Fantasy Football Sackos here, coming at you again with a new episode. Alex and I are going to be talking running backs 13 through 24. Got a little shake up at the beginning too, due to some reorganizing. It's going to be a fun one. Stay with us. Welcome to the Fantasy Football Sackos podcast with your hosts, Jason Shellcross and Alex Krogh. Let's go! How we doing? Episode 8. We made it. Episode 8. We are the Fantasy Football Sackos. I am Jason Shellcross, and this red-haired beauty of mine is Alex Krogh. How you doing, buddy? Welcome back.
I can't believe we started a fantasy football podcast in the middle of the off season when there's no football. We're idiots.
Yes. During a global pandemic, when the upcoming season is potentially questionable.
Yeah. Why do we do this?
Oh, man. Well, just trying to kill that quarantine time. But hey, nice mug, by the way. I saw that.
Hey, thanks. Yeah. We got a Fantasy Football Sackos mug that you dropped off at my house and a t-shirt.
There you go.
Which says save the sauce.
Save your sauce. With a nice little nugget on the back. Gosh.
Yeah. Look at that. I love it. It's great.
All right. Well, we got an awesome show lined up for today. We're talking running backs 13 through 24. Thank you to everybody who gave us comments and things to respond to for our mailbag episode on Father's Day. I know people were probably expecting some more rankings, but that was a nice little break for us to break up all these ranks. How was your Father's Day? Did you have a good weekend?
Yeah, it was okay. So a couple things. I think we should celebrate Mother's Day twice.
Oh, okay.
So just want to put that out there.
Cheers, ladies.
Yeah, went to grandparents' house and did yard work for them for 4 or 5 hours or three, four hours. Yes. I don't know. Holidays. It wasn't great. Yeah, so I reserve next year's Father's Day at my house so everybody could come do yard work at my house.
Well, you will be a brand spanking new father, knock on wood, Yep. Everything. Yeah, that's amazing.
And then I think I watched the Red Wedding episode. It was either Sunday night. I think it was Sunday night.
Did you have any idea? So, did you see anything coming? All right, so Game of Thrones, if you guys didn't know, Alex had never watched it. Started watching it, by virtue of this podcast, actually, I think a listener hooked him up with the HBO subscription.
What did you think? I'm paying for it.
Oh,
okay. It's all legal.
So what did you think of the Red Wedding?
I'm going to be honest with you. They deserved it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, not the wife and the child. She did not deserve it. But Rob deserved it. Mom deserved it. They made too many mistakes. They should have seen it coming.
And they were very trusting.
Yeah. So I was kind of bored of that whole storyline. So I'm kind of glad they're gone.
Bored of the storyline.
Yeah. So like the last two seasons, they like started this like war path and they've just been doing nothing for like a season and a half.
Oh, if I could only describe to you how the pace accelerates over especially the last couple seasons.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking forward to. I'm just saying their specific storyline was, hey, we're attacking. And then they just like sat there and did nothing.
Well, like the one season is like them walking to King's Landing for like 5 or 8 episodes. And it's like, are they ever going to get there? But yeah,
100%. Spoiler alert. I guess the whole thing was a spoiler for everybody else. Yeah, so sorry.
Spoiler. The show's not even on the air anymore. We're okay to talk about it, I think.
Yeah. No, I'm enjoying it, but I was glad that I gave my wife a heads up to get out of the room, especially with the being pregnant. So that was a good life decision to alert her that this episode's nickname is the Red Wedding.
Yeah.
It was a good decision.
Yep, probably. Father's Day for me was interesting. As you guys all know, my dad recently just passed, so it was the first Father's Day without him. Definitely had its lows, a couple highs though. We did a couple things that we always did when he was around. When we were kids, he used to take us on lawnmower rides up and down our street. And so we did that with the nephews. And that
was cool.
That was so much fun. We got some cool photos of doing that. And then my old man bought a convertible, and we made sure to take that out for a nice country drive on Father's Day. So it, obviously, you know, not as much fun with him here, but we tried to do a couple things that made us think of him. So good time had by all. All right, let's talk some sportsy sports. So I wanted to talk about a little piece of news that is not football. Well, it's not American football, soccer. Did you see that the Orlando Pride had to pull out of a U.S. Women's League tournament because of COVID? Have you heard anything about this?
No.
Okay. So U.S. Women's Soccer League. Basically, what they did was they put their entire season on postponement, and then they said, we're going to bring it back. We're going to bring it back. And they came up with a nine team tournament, which is all the teams in the league in Utah.
And they all get a participation trophy.
They all get to participate in the tournament. I'm not sure about the trophies. So with social distancing and everything, all little bubbles around the teams and everything in place. So what happens on the Orlando Pride? They actually went above and beyond the league's mandated testing, and they just tested everybody like one extra time. And what happens? Somebody pops positive. And so that person is like removed and quarantined. And that was on, I believe, on a Friday. And so they were getting ready to leave, I think, on Monday or Tuesday of this week. And so over the weekend, anybody that didn't test positive could have practiced. Now, the team luckily shut down all soccer operations over the weekend, and then went above and beyond and tested everybody that had contact with that person on Monday or Tuesday. The test results come back. These people had all previously tested negative, and then now six players are positive and four staff members. So it's, you know, I know it's soccer, but it's scary because they hadn't had contact with this person and they had all been tested and, you know, tested negative at the time, hadn't seen that person in 4 or 5 days, and then tested positive later. Like, the team chose to not practice over the weekend, but that was their own, on their own, you know, volition. Like, they just chose to do that out of an abundance of caution. Had they practiced, who knows how many more players would have gotten sick. And so it's going to be crazy to see, you know, it really just shows how this thing spreads, and it can spread very quickly and affect a lot of people. So there's a lot of news stories written about it today. It was written about in The Athletic and Yahoo and all that kind of stuff. So I thought it was interesting.
I think we're going to get a really good idea of what the football season may or may not look like based on whatever happens with baseball over the next month. I know that they agreed to play a 60-game season. I believe spring training part due starts, I want to say, July 3rd or something like that. First games towards the end of July. So, you know, if a bunch of people show up and a bunch of people get sick, you know, that could be a full stop right there. So, you know, it's going to be a really critical, if baseball can't figure it out where they're not, you know, piling on top of each other and touching each other most of the time. And if basketball can figure it out where, you know, there's a bunch of contact in that, even though a lot of people don't think that there is. If those two sports can't figure it out, I don't know how football is going to figure it out. So
did you see the special football helmets?
I did. They look cool. It looks like they're playing like Halo.
Yeah. Or like space troopers or something crazy out of this planet. But yeah. So I guess if anybody doesn't know that, you can like go on and Google like NFL football helmets, COVID or whatever, and you'll see it's basically a fully enclosed helmet with like a built-in air filter right where the mouth is. And the example that they gave is actually a Chicago Bears jersey. So it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, I would be devastated if football doesn't come back for a multitude of reasons. But
yeah,
the next month is going to be really critical. You know, they came out, I believe one of the doctors for the NFL Players Association came out and, you know, still encouraged players to not be practicing together. And yeah, that was just in the last week. So if that's still going on, training camps are starting in less than 2 months. I believe it's at the beginning of August, maybe a little bit earlier than that. So, you know, if they're still not letting people or not wanting people to be practicing or getting together and working out, it's going to be tough. So really critical month coming up here to determine if what sports is going to look like this fall. And hopefully all of them are going simultaneously, hockey and baseball and basketball and football, and just give
that's
it to me
be,
all.
That's going
to
be the craziest thing.
I can't
thing.
Wait. Yeah, it'll
yeah, be can great. You imagine the 30 for 30 documentaries that are going to come out of this mess, like when everything eventually kind of comes back or whatever it is?
Yeah, but they might have to actually create ESPN 8 the Ocho just to yes. hold all the sporting events. Yeah.
I guess my thing is I don't, you know, knowing the NFL, they're not going to just come out right and cancel anything. I think that they're more likely to just postpone stuff for months and then do what the MLB did and look at like a potentially shortened season and doing kind of that sort of creative stuff. As long, I think they're going to, you know, maybe if people keep getting sick, just try and hold out as long as they can and have some sort of season, but just have it later in the winter. And yeah, I don't know. Play in domes and stuff, because I mean I can't imagine going like up to the northern stadiums and stuff in the middle of January and February, but it's gonna be a interesting season.
Yeah, no more doom and gloom. Let's talk about these wonderful running backs that we kind of ended up very similar on these, even though we didn't. I think, you know, we talked a little bit pre-show about like our tiers are relatively similar except for a couple guys.
Yeah.
And so I think we're pretty much on the same page here a lot. I don't think there's going to be too much arguing, unfortunately, even though I enjoy doing it. So, yeah, let's get to it. We'll just run down. Again, these are consensus or where our average kind of falls in. Yeah. Jason decided to drop Leonard Fournette a little bit further, so we kind of have to backtrack on a guy here real quick, though.
Yeah, so originally I had Fournette in the teens, and now I have Fournette at 23. And by virtue of that, or because of that, he went from 12th in our consensus rankings to 13th, because Alex still has him at 6th overall.
Damn right.
And so now Joe Mixon went from 13th to 12th. So consensus Joe Mixon, I have him at 11. You have him at 14. I think Joe Mixon's really good at football. I just think that Giovanni Bernard is a little bit annoying to have there. He averaged almost 16 points per game weeks 8 through 17 last season, or week 8 on, and was that 16 points per game would have made him running back 8 on the season. So having him ranked at 11 and 14, I feel like it's justified. He was not running back 8 last season because he came out of the gate a little slow. So,
with weeks of 2.7 and 4.2, blazing yeah. start for people that draft him in the second round.
Yeah, yikes. Or in the first round, because he was going right at the turn.
Yeah, it's yuck.
But I mean, with Joe Burrow and AJ Green now, I guess I'm confident that AJ Green's going to be back, and I'm confident in AJ Green's ability. The guy is only 31. He was drafted in the same draft that Julio went, and I don't think anybody's questioning Julio's ability or, you know, being old. I know that they're not the same player, but I don't think he's necessarily over the hill. I think he was just upset about his contract and upset about the state of the Bengals in a lot of ways. So, but can we talk about Joe Burrow, the best quarterback in college football history? 76% completion percentage, more than 5,600 yards, 60 touchdowns, and 6 picks. Like,
That'll play.
Yeah, that'll play. And don't let the door hit you on the way out, Andy Dalton. I'm excited about the state of the offense. Honestly, I think they could take a big leap forward, and I think Joe Mixon would be a huge beneficiary of that. Again, I think the only concern is, and which is why for me, it's the start of the new tier, is because we start getting into these guys. At least for me, these are all guys that have questions, or like one thing taking away from them. And all of these guys, for me, 11 through 18, are on the same tier, and any one of them I feel like could potentially end up as an RB1. Now, Mixon averages about 45 targets a year, and Gio Bernard averages 50 targets a year. So, man, if you could just take a little bit of that away from Gio and sprinkle it on Joe Mixon, then, he'd be real nice. But that's why he is where he is.
Yeah, Joe Mixon got such a negative, stigmatism, I guess, attached to him after the start of the year last year, where for me, until I actually looked at what he did, it was one of those things where I thought he was terrible, and he ended up at running back 13, which was somewhat surprising to me. So if you add in Joe Burrow, you add in back into the mix AJ Green, you still have a bunch of talent there. I believe Boyd leads the league in receiving yards from the slot over the last 2 years. Don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure that's accurate. So if you can actually get a competent quarterback in there that can do some things, why can't Joe Mixon be right here? He can be a fringe one guy. He does. I think all of these guys have the potential to be top 10 running backs. I was surprised at how deep the running backs are, because there's so much uncertainty after the first three guys, and almost very similar to quarterbacks for me. I feel like anybody from like 5 to 20, they can all be it just kind of depends on how goal line carries shake out. It depends on how injuries shake out.
Yeah.
I feel like that's just such a big group of guys, and Joe Mixon being right in the middle of it makes sense. The biggest downside is having to play the Ravens and the Steelers four times. Probably.
Because they're not going to be running a whole lot against the Ravens, and that Steelers defense is really good.
Yeah, so playoff schedule is home against the Cowboys, home against the Steelers, and at the Texans, which is okay, I guess.
Yeah.
But I think the Steelers defense is going to be really good this year. So, you're going to get to your title game, Joe Mixon, against the Steelers is a rough one, but
yeah.
13 last year, we have him right there again this year. He's fine here. It just comes down to where do you want to pull the trigger on him, and who else is available from a quarterback or tight end or wide receiver standpoint, and what do you want to do to map out your draft? So Mixon's going to be here. ESPN currently has him at their 10th best running back, going 17 overall. So that's the middle of the second round. So he's a guy, he's got the upside. I'm probably
diving into a wide receiver instead of taking Joe Mixon if I'm there.
Yeah, I would agree.
But we got some mocks coming up. We just got to get through these rankings, and we're going to start doing some mocks and really get into this.
All right, yeah, I like Joe Mixon. He's at the right spot for us.
Let's get into our consensus 13. Good old Lenny. Lenny Fournette. So we talked about him in the last podcast, so we aren't going to get too in-depth here. I do just want to say that Leonard Fournette did have 100 targets last year. He caught 76 balls for just over 500 yards. However, he was on pace for only about 50 targets in 2018 before he got hurt. He had only had 48 targets in 2017, and he also got hurt. He was running back 9 in total points, running back 11 in points per game. Let's see his running back splits. And again, we're going to keep this real short on Leonard Fournette, because we don't really need to get into how awful he is at, or how bad he's going to be at football this year. So wow. he has a brand new coach in Jay Gruden. Lead backs for Jay Gruden in the last 6 years of his head coaching have averaged just a shave under 22 targets a year. 22 targets a year for the lead backs in 6 years.
That's not much.
That's like 1.3 targets a game. Not that I did the math.
That's not much.
And includes gentlemen by the name of Alfred Morris, Matt Jones, Fat Rob Kelly, Adrian Peterson, and Darius Geis.
And none of those guys are receivers out of the backfield.
Now, in that same time frame, Chris Thompson, since 2015, has averaged 55.5 targets a year in Gruden's system. As you guys know, and why do I talk about Jay Gruden? Because Jay Gruden is the offensive coordinator now for the Jacksonville Jaguars. And do you know who is now also on the Jacksonville Jaguars? Chris Thompson. So, I don't know, Lenny. I'd be worried about third downs. I'd be a little concerned. Yeah, so, I mean, he has 50 targets a year for the last 4 years. I don't think that there's any way that Leonard gets close to his 100 targets again. And so for that reason, I am out on Lenny Fournette. Plus, you throw in the fact that he's on a bad team that's not going to win a whole lot. And yeah, I'm not really inspired by the Jags or Leonard.
Yeah, that's fine. My only retort to that, only because I'm so high on Mr. Leo, one of my...
Mr. Leo.
Yeah, maybe I'll start referring to him as the fifth Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle with his karate skills. Is that possible? Can I do that? So Chris Thompson's 30. He hasn't played a full season in 4 years. Why should I be concerned?
He still has 50 targets a year. Could you imagine if he plays all 16 games?
Why should I be concerned about a...
Because he's an excellent... change of pace, third down back, and that is what Jay Gruden uses him as, so much so that he brought him with from Washington to Jacksonville to do the same thing.
That's fine. Or he could just, you know, throw it to Leonard Fournette, who's gonna be a beast. So
yeah. And we don't need to touch Fournette's off the field issues like in April 2019 when he was arrested for driving with a suspended license. When he was pulled over for getting a speeding ticket in 2018, when he was ejected from a football game for coming off the bench, running across the field and punching Buffalo Bills defensive lineman Shaq Lawson in the face.
Deserve it.
His multiple gestures with fans in 2018 for being chastised by then VP of football Tom Coughlin for being disinterested in a football game and called out after the football game, even though it was week 17 and the season was over. He's like, I've never been more disappointed in an NFL player than I am in Leonard Fournette.
Yeldon. You just said Tom Coughlin, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's not there anymore.
I know, but it just speaks to Lenny's character. And then Tom
Coughlin didn't know what he was doing.
Tom Coughlin was there when they drafted him in the first round. So
yeah, maybe he doesn't know what he's doing.
And also this last offseason without Tom Coughlin, the Jaguars declining his fifth year option and trying to trade him, unable to find a trade partner, and why Lenny is still in town.
We have Leonard.
We
don't need to talk about it. Consensus or average 13. ESPN has him at 13 as well, 21st overall pick. So end of the first round. I'm higher on him. I think the touchdown progression is going to happen. And good. Yeah. Maybe Chris Thompson can do some of the heavy lifting and get him down to the goal line. If he gets those 10 to 13 touchdowns,
If he has more than 40 carries in the red zone again, and only gets four scores, like that's going to
be... Yeah, what are you going
to do? That's just like the most unfortunate luck for him if that is a trend that continues. Expect some regression back to the mean there for Lenny. I just don't know how well they're going to move the ball, but yeah.
And he was number 9 last year, so
I get it.
There's no reason why he can't be a RB1 this year again.
Yep. All right, consensus 14, Raheem the Dream Mostert. I have him at 14 overall. Alex has him at 16. Alex, do you want to start with Raheem?
Yeah, I think I want to move him lower after kind of looking at things.
I almost want him higher.
Yeah, he's such a just a random ass guess as to what he's going to do, especially in that offense where Shanahan kind of just plays whoever he wants, and it is what it is. So last year they had Breida, they had Mostert, and they had Coleman. I believe they all had over 600 yards. All were, of course, were injured over the course of the year. I will add that Raheem Mostert, I believe, is 29. He's 4 months younger than David Johnson. And I feel like David Johnson's been around forever.
Yeah.
And Raheem Mostert is just barely younger than him. So, like,
Raheem Mostert was on the Bears, and now we're talking about him as an RB1, not on the Bears.
Yeah, and he was cut by like three or four other teams.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden we think he's going to. Now, he does have the potential to be the number one running back, or a number one running back, because the 49ers rushing attack, or their running backs, had 19 touchdowns last year, which is a whole ton of touchdowns.
Yep.
So if those are all going to one guy, then he's clearly going to be a RB1. One thing to think about is McKinnon coming back. And I know that this is, you can shake your head as much as you want, but he was like a top like 15 running back. And
then he had two knee surgeries.
I get it. But Shanahan brought him in just like he brought in Tevin Coleman. So it's going to bounce around. Also, keep in mind, this is kind of weird, but a guy by the name of Jeff Wilson, he had four rushing touchdowns last year.
So you just
don't know what's going to happen. You just don't know.
Let me make the case for Raheem Mostert. He had 8 touchdowns in the final 6 games.
When he was super touchdown dependent.
When he was finally anointed, he had 8 touchdowns in the final 6 games. Matt Breida is gone, freeing up 150 carries from last year. So, hello, more workload. Yes, Jerick McKinnon is on the team. However, that was exciting and newsworthy 2 years ago. Since then, he's had multiple knee injuries and knee surgeries and tried to come back last year and didn't.
You're so salty because we had a draft.
I had him and I drafted him because we had. And I'm not talking about this for the league. I'm still salty about Jerick McKinnon
because we drafted him early and my team was blown up
before the league year even started.
It was wonderful, and that's why you're so anti.
That's McKinnon. Why you draft on Labor Day weekend or whatever.
I agree.
Raheem Mostert led the league in DVOA by more than 7%. And for what DVOA is, for people who don't know, it's basically a calculation of either a person or team or group success based on the down and distance of each play during the season. Then you calculate how much more or less successful each person or team is as a group compared to the league average. And so what that means is that compared to the league average, Raheem Mostert was the number one running back by more than 7% and led in DVOA, and just crazy how good he was last year. And if we want to talk about Mr. Tevin Coleman ranked third to last in DVOA, and he was
terrible last year.
He was, man. He came out and he put up 3 touchdowns in the first half of that one game, and I thought he was going to be an RB1, and then he just wasn't good ever again after that. He was third to last in DVOA, ahead of only Le'Veon Bell and Peyton Barber.
Yuck.
So they were an excellent offense last year, and then what did they do? They went out and added Trent Williams to the offensive line. They have a beautiful playoff schedule. Washington at home in the first round. They gave up the 3rd most points to running backs last year. At Dallas, 21st most points to running backs. At Arizona, they gave up the 12th most points to running backs last season. Homeboy's putting on some weight. He's up to 200 pounds, preparing for that workload. He's consistently ranked in the 20s by pro analysts. I think is going to outperform that ranking, and I think he could be a very strong running back too. Averaged 18 points per game week 13 on last year, 17 and a half points per game, which would have been running back 6 on the season. So I think Raheem Mostert is going to be a value for a lot of people. Now, if people want to argue the Shanahan offense and him switching running backs around, I understand that people are going to get their chances, I guess. I'm just not too worried about it. I think they're going to score a ton of points, and I think they're going to run the ball a lot, and I think he's going to put up some really good points. And I think that it's going to be like it was last year, where you had like 3 49ers running backs rostered in a 12-man fantasy football league, because like if one of them goes down, one of them's an instant like RB1.
Like, right.
So, and yeah, that's with split workloads. If he's like a true, even if he has like 60 to 70% of the workload, that's great for him.
Yeah, I was going to say one thing that you might be able to kind of do too with Mostert is, you know, currently ESPN has him at 23 from a running back perspective, 54 overall.
So you're looking, say, that's like the 5th round.
Yeah, it's crazy low. And so something you can do is maybe he might get off to a slow start if everybody's healthy on that team as well. And so he might be one to target from a buy low standpoint with McKinnon if he's still healthy and makes it through a training camp without blowing out a leg, or Coleman's healthy. So it's possible that you might see Mostert be one of those guys to target at the beginning of the year, especially if he's going in the 5th. People aren't going to be valuing him there. He's one of those guys where if you don't start out by, you know, with taking running backs, and you can target him in the 4th round and have that RB1 upside potentially with those 19 touchdowns being rushed in by them last year. You can go into the season with him being your RB1 and be somewhat comfortable in my mind.
If you go 0 RB and you get your receivers out of the way and you get like Lamar or a tight end, and you get him in the 4th or 5th round, totally fine. Totally fine. Yep. Huge upside there. Now let's get into consensus 15. That is Chris Carson. I think, see, it's amazing, because I guess, you know, I'm ranking these guys and I have thoughts and whatever going through them. And I just want to, you should have, again, like we've said multiple times, you just need to have a quick opinion, high or low on a player. And I'm high on Chris Carson because I think for the first half of the season, he's going to be an RB1. And then I think Rashad Penny is going to come back and he's going to be an RB2. And it makes me sad, because it makes me think of Nick Chubb last season, when he was like a for sure RB1 for the first 8 to 10 weeks. And then Kareem Hunt comes back and Chubb wasn't really after that. And so I hope Carson keeps it up after Penny comes back, but I don't know. That's the Chris Carson question, is what's his workload between now and then. I'm not worried about Carlos Hyde at all. I mean, I think that's a for sure just backup relief situation. He was running back 12 last year in points per game at just over 14 points and 11th in total points. His playoff schedule is at home against the Jets, which were actually top 10 against the running backs, and then at Washington gave up the third most points to running backs, and at home against the Rams gave up the 17th most points to running backs. Seattle did have an almost 46% run percentage last year, which was 6th highest in the league. So, I mean, everybody knows that Seattle likes to run the ball. And at least while Penny is on the pup, you get Carson to start the season. So I think he definitely finishes around this fringe RB1, level. I think that his end of season might be a little disappointing if Penny comes back and is, you know, Rashad Penny again.
Yeah. So Chris Carson was number 11 last year, which is, you know, RB1. He's, you know, been top 15 the last 2 years, last year, you know, being 11, and the year before that, 15. He had the 5th most carries in football last year. The team that ran the ball the 4th most, just in total plays third most. They had 481 rushing attempts last year, which is insane amount of rushes. He had 39 carries inside of his opponent's 27 touchdowns, so approximately average. The biggest thing with him is going to be fumbles. Now, he had four lost fumbles last year. Yeah, led the league in fumbles with four. So, you know, if he loses the ball a couple times, it gets down on the bench. But Pete Carroll was pretty liberal in putting him back in after he fumbled. So
Fumble game where Rashad, I think, went in. But that was, I think, the only one. And then the week later, hey, here you go, Chris Carson. Welcome
right,
back.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think we have him. I think we have him ranked appropriately. Chris Carson's currently going 36 overall, the 18th running back.
Really?
So you're getting him at the end of round three, beginning of round four, which is pretty good value for the number one running back on a team that runs the ball the most. So, or not the most, but a lot. So, yeah. Again, I think all of these guys have RB1 upside. It just depends on who gets the touchdowns. It's rough.
Why? He's criminally, I think, criminally underdrafted in leagues, like, for years. I don't know. I mean, this year, maybe it makes a little bit more sense because there was an actual split, you know, at a certain point last year before Rashad went down late in the season with an injury. Like, there was a split. So I guess I understand it from that point. But I mean, if Penny can't come back until, like, what, week eight? Or nine off the pup. So
yeah, I mean, Chris Carson is also coming off of a torn ACL. So, you know, it's not like he's the perfect bill of health either, and it might take him a year to get back and going. So there are some injury concerns there, and if we're really being honest, if Seattle were to run their team most efficiently, you would think it would be let Russ cook and get the ball to Lockett and DK Metcalf.
Well, they have better weapons now than they did a couple years ago.
Right. Yeah, exactly. So if they continue to run the ball as much as they do, then Chris Carson should be ranked here. If they actually ran their offense, in my opinion, smartly and let Russell Wilson do his thing, then he should get less carries. So it just depends on game script a little bit, too, because it seems like once they get behind, Russell finally starts throwing the ball and gets them back into the game, and then they start running the ball again. So
100%.
Yeah, it's a game script thing, but Chris Carson, 18 running back, we have him approximately there. And yeah, fumbles are a concern, but if you can get those touchdowns cooking, then you're in good shape.
Running back 16, consensus. We're pretty much right neck and neck again on this person. That being Clyde Edwards-Helaire of the Kansas City Chiefs. I have him at 15 overall, and you have him at 17.
When you were ranking him, it was just trying to figure out where to drop him in, right?
Yeah, like,
we don't know that much about the guy other than some peripheral college stats. Yeah, no, exactly.
Assumption was he may not. This is what I tried to build into my 15 overall ranking, consensus 16 between the two of us. I tried to account for him not being the sole starting running back out of the gate, and that lasting approximately like 2 to 4 games, and then somebody tells Andy Reid to stop being dumb and to start Clyde Edwards-Helaire, or he breaks off some plays and then earns the job outright. You know, that being said, I really don't think that there's any competition for him to deal with. I think if this was a normal year that wasn't undergoing a global pandemic and we had a traditional preseason with preseason games where you could see how, you know, 4 games of why Clyde Edwards-Helaire is head and shoulders above the other two or three guys in the backfield, then, you know, I would probably rank him higher than the 15th where I had him. Kareem Hunt was running back 11 in 2018. And running back 4 in 2017. When Kareem Hunt was a rookie, and we talked about this previously in the top rookies episode 1.
He was 11 and got suspended, right?
I believe.
So he missed the last couple games of that season. He was still basically RB1, which is incredible.
And then he was suspended the first 8 games of 2019.
Yep.
And then there was a bye week, so he didn't come back until week 10 for the Browns. Yep. But Andy Reid traditionally is like a one running back guy, and he's very honest about workload and who's starting. And so this second he says that Clyde Edwards-Helaire will be our running back, our featured back this year. Clyde Edwards-Helaire is a probably top 12 guy for me, and I would draft him, you know, as such. And so I'm just trying to bake that in because I think he starts anyway. Damian Williams, if you take out his 2 longest runs, he averaged 2.9 yards per carry. He finished 31st in DVOA. LeSean McCoy is a shell of his former self. He was 28th in DVOA. And when Damian went down, they didn't go to LeSean McCoy. They went to a guy by the name of Daryl Williams. Like, who? So I'm not worried about the competition in the room. I'm just worried about rookie running back adjusting to a new system with potentially no preseason to get adjusted or learn the playbook. So,
yeah, and it's possible, right, that he comes on in like week 11 or 12 and wins people's titles after not doing much the first 100%. 10 games.
It's going to be interesting to see where he ends up going in drafts. You know, like if this goes on and there's no preseason, it's going to be interesting to see where people end up taking him, because somebody, and you just, maybe it's a reach or, you know, whatever, but so it'll be interesting.
Yeah. And I mean, I mentioned to you that, you know, I've seen some mock drafts where he is going at the end of the first, early second. He is top 8 running backs off the board. That's probably his ceiling. Yeah. So, and you know, one other guy that you haven't mentioned is DeAndre Washington coming over from Oakland, who did have 50 catches last year. And so he might eat into some of that work. And plus, if Patrick Mahomes is going to kind of revert back to himself from 2 years ago and have 50 touchdown passes, how much more is there to go around if running backs aren't scoring the rushing touchdowns? Now, Clyde Edwards-Helaire is a good receiving threat.
Yeah.
But rookie running backs learning pass protections, especially with the golden goose of the NFL back there, you're going to want to make sure that the running back knows their blocking assignments. So Clyde Edwards-Helaire is a total guess at this point as to what he's going to do. ESPN, currently 15th best running back, going 30. So,
him in the third.
He has the upside, though. So,
yeah.
And again, maybe he's another guy similar to Mostert. If he starts the season not doing something and somebody's going to sell low on him, he's another guy that he might try to buy into, depending on what's going on.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a little pricey for me. Consensus 17, Nick Chubb. I have him as running back 20. Alex has him as running back 13. Why don't you tell me what you like about Nick Chubb?
Nick Chubb had the second most rushing yards last year with the second worst coach in football, with Freddie Soup Kitchens. So the Browns hired Kevin Stefanski, who you might know as being the former offensive coordinator of the Minnesota Vikings.
Yep.
In case you weren't aware, the Minnesota Vikings ran the ball the fourth most amount of times in the league, just behind Seattle. Yeah, so they ran the ball 48% of the time. Cleveland last year ran the ball 40%. So, you know, even with Kareem Hunt there, in my mind, there's probably going to be enough for both of them. And just having a good offensive coach will help substantially in doing that. Nick Chubb is just really good at football. He's just really, really good. And so is Kareem Hunt. So, yeah, they might steal from each other a little bit, but that doesn't mean that he can't. You know, he's clearly already proven that he can be, RB1. He was number 7 last year. So, yeah, I I'm a little bit higher on him than you are. Again, it comes down to him converting those goal line carries into touchdowns. He had 8 last year, but based on the number of carries, it should have been closer to 12 or 13. And I know you're going to rag on him a little bit for once Kareem Hunt came back last year, but I think if they're going to, for lack of a better way to put it, almost keep the ball out of Baker Mayfield's hands and really commit to the run more, and you have Chubb and Kareem Hunt both getting 12 to 15 carries a game, which is not unreasonable for what his offense, you know, Stefanski's offense was with the Vikings a year ago, then there's plenty to go around in my mind. So
yeah,
that's why I think Chubb can be a fringe one.
So I'll talk about why I have him ranked at 20 compared to why we have Edwards-Helaire, or why I have Edwards-Helaire at 15. And I'll just run down the quick list of the guys I have in between them. So I have Edwards-Helaire at 15. I have David Montgomery at 16. I have David Johnson at 17. I have Todd Gurley at 18. And I think all those guys either are or could very well be the established three down back. And yep, for that reason, I have them all ahead of Nick Chubb. And the only other guy I have left ahead of him is Melvin Gordon, who, while I don't think he could kind of be in the same timeshare throughout the season, no matter what, that I think Chubb will be in with Philip Lindsay instead of Kareem Hunt. It's the Kareem Hunt factor, and it's the splits. If you look at the splits before and after Kareem Hunt came back, Nick Chubb stats with and without Kareem Hunt. Before Kareem Hunt, he was averaging over 19 attempts. After that, went down to 15 rushing attempts, 15 and a half. 4 targets a game, down to 2 targets a game. He scored 6 touchdowns while Kareem Hunt was suspended, and 2 after Kareem Hunt came back. He went from averaging 17 and a half points per game down to just over 12 points per game. And he only averaged 10 points per game over the last 5 weeks, including 3 of the 5 final games were single digits, and 2 of those being less than 5 points. Kareem Hunt's stats after he came back, 5.5 attempts per game. So we're not talking about a ton of rushing attempts for Kareem Hunt. It's only 5 and a half. However, he did get the vast majority of passing down work. He got he had averaged 5.5 targets per game, and he averaged double digits points per game.
Yeah, I was starting him in multiple leagues at the end of last year. He was really good.
Double digits.
Yeah.
And he did vulture 2 rushing touchdowns. Yep. And so that's the difference between Nick Chubb.
He had as many touchdowns rushing as Chubb did once Kareem Hunt came back, because they both had 2 in the same time frame. Yeah.
Yeah. And Nick Chubb would have finished with double digit rushing touchdowns and didn't because Kareem Hunt came back. So I understand that it's going to probably be a better offense, but this is sort of like a minor involvement, and you could see the impact that it had on Chubb's numbers. So unless it's amazing, like it needs to be, and like they need to win a lot more football games is really what it came down to. I think they let down themselves in the city of Cleveland, probably the state of Ohio last year. I think everybody thought it was going to be a huge year with Baker, Odell, and Jarvis, and Nick Chubb, and Kareem Hunt. Like, everybody thought that they were just going to explode.
And they should. They still should.
Yeah. Well, maybe with the proper coach, they will. But, I mean, who knows how installing a new offense is going this offseason. I couldn't imagine trying to do that. But, I guess it's the timeshare. And I understand it's going to be different coaches, but the minor timeshare still had a huge impact on Chubb's numbers. So for that reason, I have him down at 20, just because he's going to be in a timeshare all season.
It did. You're also including the last 2 weeks of the season in your numbers, where he had 4.5 and 4.7, basically when their season was over. If I could just run down,
that's championship week.
No, I know. It was also against Baltimore, so that's a rough. Were you playing him anyway?
They're in the conference.
Yeah,
playing him twice. I mean,
so once Chubb came back, just to run down the number of carries he had, because I mean, you mentioned Hunt had 5.5 carries a game, which isn't much. Chubb, starting from week 8 on, carries 20, 20, 20, 27, 21, 16, 15, 17, 15. So like, and I left off the last week, which is only 13, but their season was over. So, I mean, he's going to get the opportunities. It's a better offense, better offensive coach, better scheme, provided he gets the ball the same amount. There's no reason why he shouldn't, you know, and Kareem Hunt again can be an RB2, and it almost seems like Chubb can be an RB2 as well, you know, top RB2, low RB1, which is where I have him. Currently going, he's the 11th ranked running back on ESPN, 18 overall, which is probably...
No way.
Probably about right, honestly. I mean, people are going to take him there.
They will. It just won't be me, and that's fine.
Yeah.
It just won't be me. There's so many other guys that we have yet to talk about and have talked about that I think could absolutely get a stranglehold on the number one job that I don't want a guy splitting carries.
Yeah.
Especially on a team that lost a lot of football games last year. Consensus 18. Aaron Jones.
Dr. Jones, Dr. Jones.
I have him at Dr. 22 Jones. Overall. You have him low. You have him at 12.
Yep, ESPN currently the 7th ranked running back and 12 overall, which
I want to play that person twice in my fantasy league because oh my god. Please, I feel bad for anybody that drafts Aaron Jones in the first round.
Oh, it's going to be great when somebody, you know, right at the end of round
when one, somebody just, in our league like doesn't just, watch just the
resigns. Yeah, just resigns themselves taking Aaron Jones. Oh, he was RB2 last year. Let's get him.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Well, you have him as RB 12. I mean, that's still high. I think that's high.
I do. So I know you have stats. You've already rattled them off to me multiple times about him having most of his production in like 30% of his games or whatever.
Yeah.
So I get that. I can picture him being more consistent for whatever reason in year two of that offense. Whether he will be or not, I don't know. He probably won't duplicate his 16 touchdowns that he had last year. Rushing, he had 19 total from receiving. But even if he only had 10, you know, so you slop off, you know, 9 of those touchdowns, he still would have been RB8 last year. Really? So there is that, like, he's not going to suck. I mean, he could. No,
he's really good. Like, he's a really good running back skill-wise.
Right. Just, so, I mean, he had close to 500 receiving yards last year, which I do think is repeatable in that offense. And he had just under 1,100 yards. So from an output perspective, it was clearly there. He was he was RB2 last year. I can't just see him falling off the face of the earth. And so, you know, half the touchdowns still RB8. So I think having him at the end of round one is overly reasonable.
I think that his ceiling is just as high. I mean, his ceiling is RB1, you know, like on a individual game basis, he could be an RB1 for a week. Like, I don't think he's going to be close to being RB1 on the season, but I think he's going to absolutely blow up and destroy a couple weeks of the season. But I think he also has a really low floor. And that was true this past season. 30% of his production came in two games. Half of his fantasy output came in 4. So half of his fantasy output came in 50% of his fantasy points came in 25% of his games. He had 5 single digit scoring weeks, 1, 6, 9, 12, and 13. So really bad stretch there, like 4 or 5 weeks in a row. Week 9, single digit. Week 10 blew up for more than 20. Week 11, bye. Week 12, single digit. Week 13, single digit. So, like, helps people, like, lose their playoff race. And then he went off in the playoffs with 2 out of 3 games were more than 20 points in the fantasy playoffs last year. I don't, but yeah, maybe people,
and the other one was 18. So,
people even questioned starting him because 4 out of the 5 weeks before that, he did nothing. So, who knows if they even took advantage of it. You add AJ Dillon to the mix and potentially vulturing some goal line work, and I'm less interested. I want my RB1, if I'm drafting him there, to be more consistent than having 5 single digit scoring weeks. And yeah, I don't think the offense is a whole lot different. So I super high ceiling, super low floor. I want something more consistent. And then you add AJ Dillon, which could vulture some goal line. And I have Aaron Jones at 22 because of it. So,
yeah, I think that's considerably too low. Obviously, he's not going to be on any of your teams this year.
No,
and that's okay. You know, it's like if you're going to make a call on somebody, I would encourage people to stick by their thoughts on somebody. There's nothing worse than, man, I knew that guy was going to suck and I took him anyway.
Well,
here, you took Todd Gurley last year in one of our leagues and you hated him from the second you took him.
I did. And I traded him because I hated drafting him. But I know he's going to finish higher than 18. I guess I'm talking like there's a consistency ranking in there that I think affects him for me. And because of how inconsistent his scoring was, I have him ranked at 22. Because I would rather have 15 points a week than have like two 25 to 40 point games that prop up how he actually did on the season.
Yeah.
And I don't want to deal with that because who knows if I'm going to get frustrated and trade him away and then he blows up for 40 points against me. Like,
but so. That's the thing with running backs though. Now is it's really hard to find like, other than Christian McCaffrey, nobody was really that consistent last year, you know? So, I mean, Aaron Jones was number two. Yeah, it all came in a couple weeks.
Yeah.
But even when he wasn't doing much, I mean, just to look at his game log, starting in week four, he catches receptions of 6, 7, 4, 4, and 7. So, like, as long as that floor is there, and potentially with AJ Dillon coming in and you know, taking some of that running work, if that's going to let Aaron Jones be more of a receiving threat, then I'm okay with that too. If, you know, cause that'll help replace some of those points, especially in a half PPR or full PPR league.
Yeah.
Where it seems like he, you know, if they take some of that work and take it away from Williams and give it all to Jones, you know, he can still stay in that RB1 discussion.
Yep. My last Aaron Jones fun stat is he had 5 single digit scoring weeks. You know who else also had 5 single-digit scoring weeks? Le'Veon Bell.
Odd.
Yeah, it's a nice player to have your name mentioned alongside with, isn't it? Consensus 19, David Johnson. I have him at 17. Alex, you have him at 21. Carlos Hyde was running back 27 last year in this offense. He ran for more than 1,000 yards. I think that David Johnson is going to push 4-3 down back work. Against the likes of Duke Johnson. Carlos Hyde had 16 targets last year and Duke Johnson had 62. Mm-hmm. So if David can take a nice little slice of that pie, I think he's going to average more than one target a game that Carlos Hyde did. The Texans led the league in power blocking success according to the Football Outsiders. So nice little line to run behind for David Johnson. I think as long as he's healthy, and that's the David Johnson question mark, is David Johnson healthy? He said it was a bunch of bumps and bruises and nicks and stuff that slowed him down, and he's healthy and he's ready to be a three down back. But I mean, who knows?
So hold on. He's had bumps and bruises for 4 years.
Oh, come on. He was good in the last 4 years.
No, that was 2016 is when he was really good.
Oh, well.
So speaking of 2016, that year he had 1,200 rushing yards, 16 rushing touchdowns, 80 catches, and close to 900 yards.
That's bananas.
Receiving. Yeah, that's so it was basically Christian McCaffrey last year minus 200 total yards. That was what he did 4 years ago, and he's not done anything since.
He was still like a fringe RB1 a couple of years ago.
He was
low end RB1. He was finished RB. I think it was what, running back 10 2 years ago? Like, it was brutal.
Yeah, I'll look.
But
so in the 3 years since he had that, like, just masterpiece of a year, in total, he said 69, nice, more rushing yards in the last 3 years than he did in that 1 year.
Well, he broke his wrist in like the first or second week of the next year and then was gone the whole season. So, yeah. Yeah.
He has 6 more receiving yards than he did in that 1 year.
Ouch.
That 1 year was 4 years ago. He's 29.
Yeah. So he's young and healthy for once, and he's going to be great. Thank you for supporting in this argument.
Yeah. So Duke Johnson is a legit concern when it comes to David Johnson. Duke Johnson was running back 32 last year. As you already mentioned, Carlos Hyde was 27. So their offense is just kind of strange.
Yeah, where I don't know. I guess I just
let Deshaun kind of figure out what to do. And like Duke Johnson is still going to be the receiving threat there.
Maybe, but I also think he could be a receiver in that offense because of losing DeAndre.
Like, yeah,
I think they'll both be on the field at the same time.
Yeah, that's fair. But I mean, they have Kenny Stills, Randall Cobb, Brandon Cooks, and Will Fuller. So I don't know where Duke Johnson fits into that four wide combo.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think we have David Johnson ranked appropriately. Again, he's a guy that could be a RB1. He's a guy that could get hurt and do nothing. We have not seen him do it for 4 years. Last year, you know, they traded for Kenyon Drake because they didn't think David Johnson had anything left in Arizona. So, I mean, that should tell you something when a team gives up and trades for another running back. You know, what does this guy even have left? He did have 36 catches, 370 receiving yards, 4 touchdowns last year. But I don't know. He's a total guess. He's a sink or swim kind of guy, I feel like. And so many people have taken him so high the last 3 years that there's so many people that don't even want to look at his name on their roster.
Yep.
So
absolutely.
So what do you want to do with him? You know, our RB17 currently going 35 overall. No thanks.
Yeah. Let's move on. Consensus running back 20, Todd Gurley. I have him as running back 18. You have him at running back 20.
I love that you're higher on him than I am. It makes me happy.
I don't really want to be. Honestly, I didn't even look up Todd Gurley stats. I know what he is. He's going to be the 3-down back for the Atlanta Falcons, and he could very much be a running back 1 if his knees hold up. And that's all that the Todd Gurley discussion is. Yeah. That is the arthritis in his knees. Will his knees hold up? And that's the discussion, because there's nobody that's even remotely competition, I think, for carries or touches. Nobody. So is he healthy, and how long will he stay healthy for if he is healthy? And that's it. So he could be a running back 1, or he could, I don't know, decide his knees hurt halfway through the season, or the coach could decide that his knees hurt. And yeah,
that was the thing last year, is that they kept playing him.
They did. And I think he had his
most carries the last week of the season in week 17 when they were eliminated from the playoffs.
Yeah.
So it's like, I also didn't do any research on Todd Gurley, which is funny when you said that, because again, it comes down to health. I kind of rationalized my spot with Devontae Freeman was RB 21 last year. And so, hey, replace Devonta with Gurley, and he can be running back 21 this year.
But he could be a low end RB1. I mean, it's just
he could be a low end RB1.
Is he healthy?
He was the number one running back 2 years ago.
Unreal. Running back 21 consensus, Mark Ingram. I have him ranked at 21, and you have him ranked at 18. I think he could easily outperform where I have him ranked, but he needs to continue to be very hyper efficient to do so, because of the surrounding cast and Lamar Jackson doing a significant amount of rushing on his own. He was ranked 2nd overall behind Raheem Mostert in DVOA. He was running back 8 last year in total points, and averaged more than 5 yards per carry. So that's that hyper efficiency that I talk about that he has to maintain to match that running back 8 ranking. And if they take some more work away, or if he loses half a step, then I think that he ends up closer to this running back 21 ranking for me and 21 overall where we have him.
Yeah, and I'm happy to get Mark Ingram here, I think.
Same.
You know, the really weird thing, he had 25 catches last year and he had 5 receiving touchdowns, which is obviously not going to happen again. So you can just slop those touchdowns off. You get 15 total. You know, I can see him having 10 rushing touchdowns again this year, especially if they're going to try to keep some of the wear and tear off of Lamar and maybe turn around and hand the ball off to somebody else instead of having him run it in. So I think those rushing touchdowns are going, of all the running backs, I feel like he might have the highest floor from like a potential touchdown perspective, which kind of sounds weird, but I think, you know, he's going to get at least 7 touchdowns provided he stays healthy in that offense that runs the ball so much and they're going to score so many points.
Absolutely.
So because of that, that's why we have him as a pretty set RB2, and that's a really good set RB2. So again, this is another guy that you can get a little bit later and you're very comfortable with what he's getting you. ESPN 24 running back, 55 overall. And again, this was RB9 last year. Again. Yes. There's so many guys that are going to be sitting there.
I would like, if you go receiver, Lamar, tight end, Raheem Mostert, Mark Ingram.
Yeah, that's unbelievable.
Like, I don't know where these ADPs, maybe they'll change. Who knows?
I would assume that they would, but I feel like we're somewhat in kind of an era where you have, where running backs are more expendable than ever, obviously. So you have all these guys that have already had, you know, pretty good years that are just kind of sitting there and you're trying to figure out who's going to be like the next guy to step up. And do you really want to put your faith in an older running back?
Yeah.
Even though the production might be there. So the guys around Mark Ingram, so Kareem Hunt is one spot below him, which is ridiculous. And you got Mostert, Connor, Singletary, Gordon, Bell, Carson, David Johnson.
What is this, the ADPs right now?
Yeah.
Wow.
So those are running back rankings going up. Sorry. Ingram, Mostert, Connor, Singletary, Gordon, Le'Veon, Chris Carson, David Johnson. But like, there's no reason why Mark Ingram can't perform all of those guys.
Yeah. Yep. Moving on, running back 22 consensus, David Montgomery, my running back 16, Alex's running back 25. Alex, why don't you take it away? Why do you have him ranked outside of the top 24?
I don't trust their coach.
Okay.
You still have Sharik Cohen there. It didn't really seem like they ever really committed to giving him the ball, and I think the Bears' offensive line sucks. So that's a big part of it for me. I also don't know who their quarterback's going to be. It just seemed like they went away from the run too much last year as a Bears fan, and it seemed like he like forced running plays when he didn't need to, and I don't know. He seems like he's a good running back, but in that offense where you don't know how many points they're going to score and how many opportunities there are going to be at the goal line, that's just why I have him low.
All right.
No statistics whatsoever. Totally a gut call.
All right. Totally gut call on Mr. Monty. I got some info. I guess my gut says, I don't think that. I guess I'm not worried about Tariq Cohen. I think he is a three down back. I think if Tariq is on the field, it's in a two back set. And I think Monty's still on the field as an option. So the Bears traded for Nick Foles, who could potentially be much better than Mitch Trubisky. I guess we won't really know. He does know the Nagy offense, which is good.
I'm still a Mitch guy, just for the record. I know
that's fine. Off topic, I mean, I'm not really one way or the other. I mean, Mitch, I think, is an average quarterback who is above average if he has a good offensive line, and he did not have good offensive line play last year, and that's why he struggled. But the Bears added 7 offensive linemen. So they understand it's an issue too. They
let's throw some shit at the wall and see what sticks.
Yeah. So they added 7 offensive linemen to try to fix the offensive issues. And that's what it was. The offense broke down because there wasn't anybody to block for them. I mean, Kyle Long ended up leaving and got pulled out during the halftime of the Raiders game. And like,
he was so bad. Oh my God.
He just, yeah. But I know one thing, and I know that David Montgomery is good at football. He went to the Iowa State University, and that's not why he's good, but it means I got to watch him play, and I know what he can do. And what he can do is this. He can force 100 missed tackles in his last year of college, which is more than double the next person in the Big 12, and led the FBS in missed tackles. Like, the guy is, he's good at making people miss, and he is a good running back. He needs.
Unfortunately, he was doing it like 3 yards behind the line of scrimmage last year. He got the ball.
Exactly what it was. And so, do I believe that they fixed their offensive line issues? I think that they maybe not fixed completely, but I think that they come close. Like, if he's moderately better, I think he could easily be. If the offensive line is even moderately better, I think he's a for sure RB2. Wow. And I want to talk a little bit about Tariq Cohen since you brought him up. While his pass work has gone up every year, his running work has actually gone down, especially after drafting Montgomery.
Because Nagy doesn't run the ball.
He only had 64 rushing attempts last year when he had 99 the year before. And his pass game involvement wasn't very impressive last year either. He averaged 10 plus yards per catch in 2018, which went down all the way to 5.5 yards per catch last season. I think he's a gadget mismatch guy, and is really just mediocrely involved in a passing game that last year only supported one wide receiver in terms of fantasy. And I think that his days as a, you know, RB2 flex guy were pretty much over the day that the Bears traded up for Montgomery. So
David Montgomery was a top 15 running back twice last year after the bye week. Here's his running weekly fantasy points scored in a half PPR.
Oh, 0.9, I know that they're not pretty.
0.9, 22.7, 21.1. So those are good. And then 6, 5.5, 4.1, 15.7 on Thanksgiving. 6.6, 5.4, 6.4.
Yep.
Not good.
No,
bad. Actually, that's real bad.
Not good offensive line. And so you add 7 guys to the offensive line. You try to fix it. And I'm just saying,
none of which were drafted.
No, they drafted several offensive linemen.
OK, yeah. Late in the draft. And then the rest of which were just released from other teams.
So.
There's no way he's going to be an RB1.
Seahawks. He wasn't junk. He's not junk. I'm just
Nobody else picked him up.
Where does ESPN have Mr. Monty?
The 27th ranked running back, 65 overall.
So I will probably end up with Montgomery a lot because I have him higher than that, which means I'm probably going to take him.
Good luck.
Thank you. I will. I'm going to be happy because go Bears. I don't think I've ever had a Bears running back as a Bears fan, so it'll be fun.
Yeah. Matt Forte was fun in 2008.
Jordan Howard was an RB1 for years.
Sure.
Consensus 23, Melvin Gordon. I have him at 19th. You have him at 27. I feel like 27 is a little insulting.
Yeah, it's too low.
I think he could push potentially for 3 down back status. Maybe. I don't know. You really? I think. He's so much bigger than Philip Lindsay.
Philip Lindsay has 1,000 yards rushing back to back years. And
he's an undrafted guy who's like 5'8, a 185 dripping wet. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, he's just not going to go away, though. He's going to be there all year.
I think he's
going to
go away in the red zone.
He has 16 touchdowns the last 2 years.
Yeah. Yep. But there's also a reason that they signed Melvin.
I don't disagree with that, other than the fact that nobody wants to pay running backs.
Yeah,
so true, he had to go somewhere.
For me, I think Melvin Gordon's fantasy output is going to go as far as Drew Lock takes that offense. I don't think really anybody has a better set of weapons than he does right now with Cortland Sutton, Noah Fant, Deshaun Hamilton, and then they added Jerry Jeudy and KJ Hamler. Like,
you don't think Pat Mahomes has a better weapons than him?
I don't know.
Oh no. You don't think Tom Brady has better weapons than him?
Yeah, okay, Tom Brady does. But the Broncos offense is
Drew Brees.
Maybe.
I won't keep badgering you.
That's fine.
We'll just let that one pass.
Top ten in weapons, I'd say.
Ugh.
You don't think so? I think Cortland Sutton is a stud. Noah Fant is a stud. And Jerry Jeudy is the man. So,
all right, you talk. I'll put together a list of 10 right now.
Oh, here we go. And that's where I have Melvin. Is there anything else you want to add, or do you want to get to 24?
No, I think I am too low. The biggest thing with Melvin, there's a huge unknown of what he's going to do in a brand new offense with Philip Lindsay being there. There's just so many unknowns. Currently he's going 20. He's ranked the 20th best running back on ESPN, 38 okay. overall. So he's going in the fourth round, which is very reasonable. So, you know, again, another guy that has been an RB1 in the past. And he's going to be sitting there staring at you in round four, and you're going to be like, Melvin Gordon's here. Let me take that guy.
Number 24 consensus. I don't, there's so many other guys I think I could justify putting here over Le'Veon.
There's so many guys that we'd rather talk about than him too.
Yeah. That are so much more exciting. Like Le'Veon is here. Because he has to be, but not because I want him to be. He was running back 17 last year in total points. He was 21st in points per game at just over 12 points per game. Did nothing inspiring at all last year. He had 5 single digit games, as mentioned earlier, when talking about Aaron Jones. The team signed Frank Gore, who could potentially steal some short yardage and goal line work from Le'Veon. Not that there's going to be a whole lot of it going on with the Jets. And he, again, really uninspiring runner last year. He was ranked second to last in DVOA behind Gore and Coleman and only ahead of Peyton Barber. Like, I would much rather be like, I think, talk about an inspiring rookie like a Devin Singletary or something like not, rookie, you know, but he's a second year player, but he has, I think, a higher ceiling than Le'Veon does or Jordan Howard. Or Taylor for the Colts, or your guy Ronald Jones, who we haven't talked about. So,
yeah, the crazy thing to me is that the Jets went 7-9 last year, and
I don't think they win a game.
Yeah, it's crazy. So ceiling's obviously there for Lev. Just depends on if Adam Gase can figure out how to get his best players the ball, which he has a history of showing that he cannot do that, especially with running backs.
Yeah.
So. Other guys, honorable mention guys that we haven't talked about, or honorable teams we haven't talked about. We've not talked about a Patriots running back yet. We're sitting at 24. So Sony Michel, James White, both have been top 24 running backs prior to this year. So they are sitting there. You mentioned Devin Singletary, who, you know, we've talked about their first 6 weeks being a cupcake walk. So potentially he gets off to a really hot start and can definitely be an RB2. We've not talked about the Colts. So you have Marlon Mack, you got Taylor, the rookie from Wisconsin. Again, Marlon Mack is historically an RB2 as another guy. So that's on the AFC side. On the NFC side, we did not talk about the Redskins. Darius Geis, Peyton Barber is there. We did not talk about the Lions, which is Kerryon Johnson and DeAndre Swift. Even though a lot of people are really high on Swift, again, it's another thing where if Stafford stays healthy, they're going to be airing it out. And so, you know, how much do you even really want one of those guys? Offense. Yeah, exactly. We did not talk about the Bucks, which is Ronald Jones, who I'm actually quite high on this year, and Keyshawn Vaughn. And we also did not talk about the Rams, which is Malcolm Brown and Daryl Henderson.
And Cam Akers.
Yeah. Okay. But so, I mean, it seems like to me, and I know we're wrapping up here, But it seems to me that there's a lot of running back depth a little bit later in the fourth and fifth round, to where, which could give you very similar output to the guys that you'd be taking in rounds two and three. So at least initially, I know it's still June, but it seems like it's probably worth waiting on some of these guys that have that high RB2, low RB1 upside, getting them in the fourth and fifth round, where if you hit on them, all of a sudden it's like you're sitting with an RB1 and you're like, oh sweet, I have
you have Lamar with it, or you have Kittle or somebody at tight end.
Yeah, exactly. So,
or another awesome receiver.
Yeah, that's like my first thought is, like, you're sitting there with Michael Thomas and you're sitting there with a tight end and you're sitting there with like Mahomes, and then like you can just
That's three rounds. So maybe, you know, round four is Raheem Mostert. Round five is like David Johnson, Todd Gurley, Melvin Gordon.
Yeah, that's right. Inherently, you're going to look at that Mark team Ingram. And be like, oh, sweet, I have like the 2018 All-Stars. But they're still going to be productive in 2020. Yeah. So you have to like get over recency bias and try to project out where these guys are going to go. And it just seems like there's so many guys that you can have on your team that maybe might surprise you upon taking a first look at running backs. Like it surprised me of like, oh, like I'd be fine with a couple of these guys being my two running backs, and you can get them a little bit later.
Yeah. So I think before we wrap up, I want to just talk about real quick, where would you take the first wide receiver, knowing where the top 24 running backs are? The first four running backs are McCaffrey, Barkley, Elliott, and Dalvin. Would you take Michael Thomas over any of those four?
Yeah, I'd take him over Dalvin.
Okay, if Dalvin signs a contract, would you take him over Dalvin?
Yeah, and so we actually haven't really talked about this, and I literally keep writing it down every podcast, and I fail to mention it. Dalvin Cook's never played 16 games. So he's never stayed healthy the full year, and it seems like he's always banged up. And
do you have pick four? You're taking, assuming McCaffrey, Barkley, and Elliott are gone, you're taking Michael Thomas.
That's correct.
Okay, I'm taking Dalvin, and then after that, I'm probably taking a receiver. I'm taking probably Thomas over Kamara, Henry, Drake, and all those guys.
Yeah, that's fair.
Assuming Dalvin signs. If he doesn't sign, then he'll be moved way down. Gordon last year.
Yeah, you don't know what that offense is going to look like with Kevin Stefanski leaving, where they ran the ball so heavily. And Kirk Cousins was really good last year.
He was. And
people don't really like he was like a QB1 for the first like 8 weeks or 9 weeks of the year, until they started just turning around and giving the ball to Dalvin until he got hurt. And then,
yeah,
like what usually happens. So yeah, that's where I would fall is Michael Thomas early. And especially as soon as you get to a guy that you don't want and that's why tiering is so important. And as soon as you get to where your tier is, it's time to switch over to the other side sort of thing and look at, hey, where's your other tier at? My tier is after Zeke, your tier is after Dalvin. That's why we have Michael Thomas where we do. And so it's really important to establish, hey, I think there's a, like literally just drawing a line, I think there is a difference between this guy and this guy, and that's where you start slotting in the other positions in your draft.
Yep. We'll leave it there, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you guys for listening. This has been fun talking about running backs. We have receivers up next, and then we might just throw tight ends. I don't know what we're going to do with tight ends. We'll have to figure that out. I don't know if we want to dedicate a whole episode to them, but
no, we do. Tight ends are deeper than you think they are.
Huh? Well, there you go. You heard it here first. So we got receivers and tight ends coming up, and then we're going to start doing some mock drafts. Stay with us. Don't forget to like, subscribe. We're on every platform you could imagine as far as listening to us outside of YouTube. And on our social medias, we are at the FF Sackos. Please follow us for some grade A fantasy football content. And with that, thank you so much. Have a good night. Peace.
Can't you just imagine people's excitement when you tell them that we're going to be going deep on tight ends in a couple episodes? That's got to get people really excited.
So deep.